Okay, I'm gonna start with taxes. I filed the tax cut bill a couple of years ago that OCPA had put out with a study from Art Laffer. And we had quite a bit of success. That year, we started out with 12 tax bills. We ended up with two the last day of session, mine and the governor's. At the end of the day, we didn't get that through, but what I think we did was baby step the idea back into our Republican legislature that tax cuts were okay. What's distressing is that who we have to fight a lot of times are not the Democrats. They don't have the numbers. It's fighting our own Republicans that will come out and say things like, can you make it a revenue-neutral tax cut, to which I always say revenue-neutral tax cut is an oxymoron. That's impossible. And the second thing is that they'll say, well, you know, in a year like this where gross production, you know, is down, revenue's down so much. And I'm like, no, that's a fallacy put out by the papers. This is the highest revenue ever brought in state history this year. Instead, what we did during the recession was we robbed from Peter to pay Paul. We did different things like that that are now coming home to roost. We also tend to tie our own hands by when we see something that we think is a wonderful idea, like OLAP, which is Oklahoma's promise. We'll say, well, I don't really trust future legislatures to fund this, so we're gonna take this off the top. So we have this $17 billion pot that we have made so many little funnels off the top for roads funds and college scholarships that now we only get to appropriate about $7 billion of it. I plan on writing a bill next year to take every funnel off the top and put the entire pot back where we can have a true A&B process and actually make our own decisions on where things need to go. The one thing the legislature is tasked with every year is not to run bills that legalize marijuana and things like that. What we're tasked with is staying a budget-friendly state that is, we are a balanced budget state, and that we have to run the core services of government effectively, and that is basically all we're tasked with, and I think that we need to take that more seriously. The bill that I filed this year would take us from 5.25 to 4% over the next 4 years. Every time that we've cut taxes, in the last decade, we've gone from 7% to 5.25. Every single time we have cut taxes, more revenues come in the next year. I know I'm preaching to the choir again, but everybody realizes that nobody puts that money in a tin can in the backyard. So every small business owner puts it back into the business. They hire more employees, they buy equipment, people spend the money. So basically, every time it has worked, and it will work again. I have 20, Tom is one of the co-authors on the bill. I think we have like 25 co-authors on the bill. It passed the first hurdle, which was the Revenue Tax Committee. I will be honest, if any of you have representatives or senators in your district, you may need to call them, because we had speaker elections this week, and I heard that we may have a little trouble getting it further down the road, because some of our own Republicans may think it's not the year for a tax cut because they think we'll have less revenue to spend. And I know everybody in this room understands economics enough to know that's not true, but sometimes we have to educate our own Republicans. And with that, I'll turn it over to Representative Newell.
Well, let the Senator go.
Okay.
My name is Rick Brinkley, and I'm
chairman of the Senate Pension Committee. One of the things that you learn pretty quickly at the state legislature is that because a lot of, oh, just like at home, old shows up 10 minutes late. Believe it or not, we sat back in front of each other on the floor, so this is going to be like a regular day for us, is that we do not have a huge spending problem as far as a debt problem, I guess is a better way of saying it. A debt problem in this state because we can't spend money we don't have. We're not like Washington. We cannot do deficit spending. However, when Senator Holt and I were both elected in 2010, our unfunded liabilities of pensions was $16 billion. We passed legislation. Now, I have to pause there to say this, is that very similar to what Representative Osborne said, is that my favorite way of describing this is under Democrat control, they gave unpaid COLAs every 2 years across the board to every pension fund to help guarantee their victory in the elections, with no, and never paid for them. And they knew that someday there would be a legislature somewhere down the road that was going to have to deal with this issue. And then under Republican leadership, as opposed to Democrat control, we have started to address the pension fund issue in this state. In 2010, we were elected, a bill was passed that said you cannot do a COLA unless you've got the money to pay for it. You cannot assume a COLA. As a result of that, on paper, overnight, the unfunded liability went from $16 billion down to $10 billion. 2 years later, that $10 billion is back to $11 billion. So this is the issue that we have been tasked with getting a handle on. I've got Senate Bill 2120. It is a bill that takes state employees that are in the OBERS, or Oklahoma Public Employees Retirement System. New employees beginning November 1, 2015 will be in a 401k style retirement. Now I have to also pause because we have to keep promises to those who are in the retirement system. They've worked under the guise, they made the contributions that they would have these things when they retire. So no one currently in the system, and also just so everybody knows, and the one thing that I have learned in being in the short time I've been in the legislature is people who oppose you have no obligation to tell the truth. I apologize for the way I'm dressed today. I've had two soccer games this morning, and I've got one more to go with my grandson, and teachers approached me on soccer fields and said, we understand you're taking away teachers' pensions. Teachers are not in the bill. We can't, by the Baker decision, the Oklahoma Supreme Court, we cannot affect anybody who is currently in the system, because you cannot take away what it is that they have been promised, they've been donating to, but that's not the messaging that the opposition will put out. They will tell their members, they're taking away your pension, which is absolutely 100% false. And first of all, no one would want to do it. Second of all, the Supreme Court prevents us from doing it. What this does is that it allows us, I won't get into the weeds of the bill except to say, and with the legalization of marijuana bill, I guess the weeds is probably a poor choice for it. One of the things that happens is that we've got three things to do. We've got to be able to protect those who are currently in the system and are current retirees, make sure they get everything that they've been promised. Second thing is that we've got to have a retirement system that's reflective of this next generation of employees. Everything that everyone has ever read about the millennial generation is that they will have 5 to 7 careers over their lifespan. By having a 401k style retirement system, they can have a retirement match, it's portable, they can take it with them when they leave, and they can continue to have that same kind of system that the other 98% of America has in their jobs. It is very frustrating to deal with the sense of entitlement that a state employee is entitled to a pension. I don't believe that anyone is entitled to a better retirement system than those who are paying the taxes to fund that retirement system. And then the third thing we've got to do is that we've got to do what it is that everyone knows that we need to do and take responsibility on this, and not leave these unfunded liabilities to continue to grow for our grandchildren to be forced to deal with because the people before us didn't do their jobs. So that, in a nutshell, is a little bit on pensions, and I'm looking over here to see if there's anything else you wanted me to include in that. Is that good? All right, and I'll turn it over to Representative Newell.
You want to? Senator Hope.
Okay.
Rick does deserve your gratitude. He's working really hard on that. And really, the people in this room, I saw a lot of pins moving, and that's good, because the people in this room are the ones who will combat that misinformation, because what Rick's doing is really important. And it's always, it seems like we live in a conservative state until it's my stuff that's being cut, you know, and that's what you're going to have to explain to people. In this case, it's not. In fact, what he's trying to do is save for those people long term. I think I'll just take 3 or 4 minutes and maybe talk about the tax cut odyssey from as I see it. I'm unencumbered from having heard Representative Osborne remarks because I was late, but hopefully I won't be too duplicative. But I came into the legislature along with Senator Brinkley in 2010 with, you know, overwhelming Republican majorities, which, you know, get bigger every election cycle. And I had known for years that we had a relatively high income tax rate. Now, our tax burden overall is actually pretty low, and we're still, I think, a low tax, low little government state. But our income tax rate is relatively high. I say relatively high to say that it's not in like the top, you know, 5 tax rates in the country, but it's not, you know, one of 9 or 10 states that don't have income tax at all. It's certainly far from that. And as other states around us continue to compete with each other, like Kansas, we're starting to get, you know, fall farther down that list. And as you know, historically, over the last 20 years, we moved it down a lot, and that was good. You know, it used to be 7, now it's It was 5.5 when we took office, and then a previously scheduled cut took effect and moved it to 5.25. But it's still, to me, relatively too high for several reasons. One is, you know, the pure economic development, pure checklist. You know, when business and job creators are looking at the checklist of where they want to start their companies, start branches of their companies, you know, live and work. They do look at that list. Now, I don't think normal people, as I define them, look at that list. I get that. I don't think some 21-year-old thinking about where he's going to, you know, live, he probably even cares a lot more about the thunder than he does, you know, the income tax credit. I get that. But people who are established job creators and entrepreneurs, they do look at that sort of thing. And I think we need to be competitive. So I think that's part of it. And counterintuitively, of course, and you know this, you know, the lower your rate, the more people move here and create businesses, and the more income tax you actually get in the end. So, I mean, it's a win-win situation for everybody if you do it right. You know, another reason, of course, is to continue to put pressure on maintaining a limited government. There is a certain mission creep, and when one party ran the state for 100 years, we had a lot of that. And I think our state government, though not as egregious as the federal government, does, you know, does a lot of things that it really doesn't necessarily need to do. And programs never die, you know, no matter how hard you try. But it seems like the only thing that ever puts pressure on that situation and restricts mission creep and even pulls it back, and maybe even kills a program, is when revenues are tight. I don't think that's the end of the world. It can feel that way at the state capitol, you know, when, oh, we're down, we've got to cut everything 5%, it's the end of the world, you know. That's what we'll hear, you know, people coming into our office, you know, like it's a bad thing. It's not necessarily a bad thing when you still have services and things that are not done as efficiently as possible. And I know that you know, everybody uses the phrase like fraud, waste, and abuse, or whatever. I mean, of course, there's that. But look, you know, look at the fact we have 520 school districts. Look at, you know, all these things that continue to stare us in the face. And I don't know that we'll ever really address those until we continue to have. Limited government based on a low income tax. So now, what I just said, I recognize is in some opposition. You lower the rate and you get more business and you get more income tax, or you lower the rate and you have more pressure put on the revenue and therefore you're shrinking the government. And that's true. One of those two things will happen, and I like it either way. You know? So, now, having said that, that's somewhat of a radical view. I get that. We have a lot of legislators who don't like that second option. They're fine with the option where we lower the income tax and businesses grow and we have more money to spend at the state capitol. They're not so fine with the option of cutting, because that means hard choices and that means facing people that are not very happy. And so we run the gamut in our caucus, and that's why you haven't seen necessarily a dramatic tax cut or any tax cut. I mean, we did pass one. It got struck down. So, I mean, we did get one all the way to the governor's desk, but now we're back at square one because of the Supreme Court decision. And so we haven't, you know, the record will show, we have not passed a legitimate income tax cut in the 4 years we've been there. And I think that's somewhat disappointing, and ought to be disappointing to a lot of people who fought so hard to have these overwhelming Republican majorities. But it's because you have pretty broad spectrum of opinion. I mean, you probably have people that wouldn't say it in public who would just assume raise the income tax. Then you got people that are fine with an income tax cut but want to see it be truly revenue neutral. And we're probably on the same page in the sense that I'd like to see some of the reforms that those people would advocate in terms of tax credits and things that might bring money back onto the balance sheet. But I'm probably from the caucus that's maybe on the other extreme that would just as soon lower the rate and let's see what happens. And I'm okay with really either outcome. I don't need a revenue offset up front, because I do believe that ultimately it will balance out. Because as I bet Leslie said, even though I missed it, we've lowered our rate 25% over the last 20 years, but the revenues have increased 25%. Now, that's not necessarily going to continue all the way to zero, but I don't know that we've hit that downside of the laffer curve yet. So I have introduced a tax cut every year I've been there, and I think what we need to do is continue to just work the angles, try to find some moment when all the things align and we can get this done. But there are other moving parts, like the size of our government and mission creep and trying to balance all that. And you almost have to have some parties in our legislature, while we're working on tax cuts, working on, you know, spending cuts and maybe tax credit reform and all those things. All those things kind of have to come together for it to work. And that's partly why we maybe haven't had that leadership to put all that together. And that's why we're sitting here with that tax cut 4 years into Republican rule of the state. So with that, I guess I'm over, give it back over to Tom, but I'd love to entertain any more questions if you think I haven't covered something about tax cuts and why we are where we are today. But I'm trying to give you a feel for why it's been so hard the last 4 years to get this done, but we're still trying.
Should we elect some Democrats?
He asked if we should elect some Democrats. I don't think that's going to help, but it's a nonpartisan event.
You know, that's a great segue to a little what I want to talk about. We've heard a lot about policy today, and it's kind of preaching the choir for me to talk to you more about reducing the income tax, limiting government, you know, focusing on the core functions of government, which is something that Leslie and I also work on in the House. And, you know, we've got to fund the core functions. That doesn't even mean necessarily, however, that our core functions of government are spending their money wisely. And then we have a lot of non-essential functions, but trying to get good conservative policy through, as you've heard, is very difficult. And that's because not all Republicans are created equal. And we have tremendous battles. I mean, we've got a good solid group that signed for the tax cut, but that's still a minority of the majority caucus. And it's very difficult to try to get Republicans, even oftentimes, to consider, maybe this isn't a core function of government, we don't have to spend it. Why can't we lower taxes? Well, because I'm afraid of X, Y, and Z, and they go through all that. So I just want to be very clear when I make these next couple of comments that I am not advocating electing Democrats necessarily, or even advocating primary challenges against my colleagues. What I do want to say to you today is that as conservatives, we have to become more strategic going forward. For instance, I'm also a pastor, as Senator Don mentioned, and I think we would all agree to the truth. If someone stands at a street corner with a sign that says "Turn or Burn," well, as Christians, we would agree that statement is correct. However, I would disagree that it's probably not very effective in accomplishing much. And oftentimes, for us as conservatives, we don't tend to be very effective or strategic in getting the right message out there. So for instance, we've heard an awful lot today about policy and why tax cuts are important and why they work. All very true, but it's important that we don't just get in echo chambers and just talk amongst ourselves all the time. We have to be strategic in taking that message out to our neighbors and the people in our churches and others. And we have to do that in a very effective manner so that we can win them over so they can help us in the long term. Secondly, I would just encourage you, even now as we have these things, and Senator Osborne mentioned this, you know, elections have consequences. We just had some internal elections in the House, and that has consequences. But one of the things we oftentimes hear from our fellow representatives is, well, I'm never hearing any of my constituents say they want a tax cut. They honestly say that. Now, what they do hear from are all the tax consumers. Most of them have lobbyists, and they show up constantly on why we can't do a tax cut and why we can't limit spending. So they need to hear from you and from all the other people that you have won over about why you want a tax cut and why it's important to our state and why you want them to focus on core functions and et cetera. Secondly, I would just say, and this is becoming, I think, increasingly true, you know, liberals have for years been strategic. And we didn't get to where we are overnight. They have been very strategic over the years in growing government, raising taxes, and all those things. So I would just say to us as conservatives, as we're trying to engage others, that we're strategic in that when we have a conservative in the legislature, don't say that you have to agree with me 100% of the time, or I'm going to get mad at you and threaten a primary challenge and throw you out. That's not very effective. Leslie and I are both conservatives. We were laughing earlier, but we don't always agree on everything. We don't become enemies because we don't agree on everything. We still work together to advance the conservative cause. I would also say that oftentimes two conservatives agree on the end game, but we just have a little bit different ideas and a strategy to get there. Those are good, healthy conversations. And just because my fellow conservative disagrees with me on strategy, the key is they're still my fellow conservative, and I want to continue to engage them and work with them. So it's rough for a legislator at the Capitol to already know that the liberals don't like them. And then suddenly, because they do one thing, and now all their conservative friends are hollering and calling them a traitor, you're just not accomplishing a whole lot that way. So I would encourage us, as we go back and engage our friends and families and relatives, and we begin to educate them becoming more conservative, that then we take the long-term approach. And I mentioned earlier not to advocate a primary challenge, and there's several reasons I would say that. One is sometimes we get all fired up and angry, and so someone decides to run, and they run kind of in the style of turn or burn, and they get beat soundly by that incumbent, and all that does is embolden that incumbent to say, I don't have to listen to conservatives. They already tried to beat me once, and they can't do it. So it's actually self-defeating. But what you can do is continue to build a grassroots base, because we're all face term limits. So at some point, that seat's going to become open. And if I am gradually, slowly but surely building a good, solid conservative base, then when that seat comes open, then I can elect a good, effective conservative legislator to help advance the conservative cause. So I would just encourage us to become more strategic as we move forward.
We're going to take questions from the audience here in just a second. I wanted to start off, though. Several of you have mentioned false information that's being distributed or being tossed out there as fact. Senator Brinkley mentioned teachers are going to lose their pensions when, I'm too hot. How's that? Is that?
The line's off, yeah.
Okay, how's that? Right. That's tough.
Which I did.
Hey, we're good. So, Representative Osborne also mentioned how tax revenues are at all-time highs, so you wouldn't know that from reading some of our state's larger periodicals. So I'm going to ask about another one. We hear a lot about the state of Kansas and how they are destroying their state by having the biggest income tax reduction in state history, going from well above Oklahoma's penalty on work to below ours in just 1 year. And my friend Jonathan Small may allude to later, I think that some folks have literally said it's turning into Bangladesh up there. When you hear that from your colleagues in the legislature or from others in the Capitol, what are you saying? Why do you think Kansas might actually be worth looking at as possible lead to follow as opposed to something to avoid?
We don't have a mic.
Oh.
Leslie, you want to take?
I guess what I would say is Tom and John and I were just on a really great trip to Topeka and met with Governor Brownback. And I don't know how many of you all are familiar, but he is a hero. This is a man that came back from the U.S. Senate and basically said, we are going to change the way things are here. Now, the funny thing is he was the immediate follower of Catherine Sebelius. So it was like going from black to white. And when we were there, we were touring their Capitol, which was a fabulous renovation, the most beautiful state capitol I've probably ever seen. And I said, well, we just finished it. It was a $300 million bond issue. So I said to him, how did you get that done? They said, oh, well, Sebelius passed that last year before she left. But we asked him, you know, you read the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and it says that Kansas, that, you know, that you're having to sue in your state Supreme Court for education funding, that things are falling apart. And they said, no, that's total fallacy, total misnomer, that actually there has been no dip, none, in Kansas revenue since it happened. This is the first year that they may see a dip. Now, they did do one thing. They extended a 1 cent sales tax that was supposed to expire for an extra year or two because, and you probably heard the story, but in Kansas, the Senate, the Republican Senate, didn't want the tax cut, so they loaded it up like a Christmas tree and made it so low that they thought there was no way Governor Brownback would sign it. And he took it and said, okay, I'll sign it, and just absolutely flabbergasted them. And you know what? The world has not fallen apart. They have, I think they have no rainy day fund, and they've gotten up to a great amount. I can't remember the number. I think a half a billion. Their core functions are moving smoothly. We drove through the state. Their roads and bridges are probably better than ours. And what you hear, you've got to take with a grain of salt. And I know we're all Fox News believers and everything, but what's scary is when the Tulsa World and the Oklahoman are reporting those kind of things. And they are. We used to have very conservative papers in this state, and we don't anymore. It's my understanding that Soros is working on buying up all the newspapers in red states. And that's a brilliant strategy. And it really scares me to death because a lot of people read verbatim what they see in a paper and believe it, or what they read on the internet, and that's a scary thing. So we're going to have to be the ones that go out and combat these kind of things, because the paper and the media is not going to do it for us, even in the reddest state in the country.
Anybody else want to take this one? I saw a hand up. That gentleman there.
My question is, Rick kind of answered it, but...
I got a mic for you. Hold on.
Okay. My question is, what outside pressures are you feeling from public unions, all public unions, and what are you doing to curb their demands?
Well, we're hearing from a lot of all of the unions who are not even, and they're not all technically quote-unquote unions or employee groups, just so that way that everything is quoted, that it's correct, is that if you can dress up any way you want to, but it is what it is. Is that the state employees are in this bill. We are getting marches, people coming to the Capitol from teachers, police, fire, who are not even in the bill because they're always afraid that they will, it's very aggravating because when I go out and speak and say, you know, your organization is not in the bill, and you get this resounding word, yet, from everybody else, because they're afraid that, as they call it, it's the camel's nose under the tent. So I'm going to answer your question with two points. One is that we're hearing from all of them, and they're all opposing any kind of pension reform. They have formed an organization to fight pension reform. Now, the second part of what are we doing is that we're moving forward, is what we're doing. I can't say that we are backing off of anything that we are looking at doing. We're moving forward. We're trying our hardest to be able to communicate the best way we can to our constituents, trying to talk to individuals within those groups. As I said earlier, I got stopped at the soccer field today, and as I told this happened to be a female teacher, I said, no, we cannot do anything with your pension. You're in the system. It was very funny. Her husband turned to her and said, see, I told you so. When they are inundated with materials that if I were in their shoes, I would believe it too, because the people that I am paying to represent me are telling me this is what's happening. You would believe it too. And so we're trying to get the word out. We're working with AFP. We're working with other groups to be able to help us message this, as Representative Google talked about. A lot of times it's not what you do, it's how you say it. And we've got to get the right messaging out, and we're working on that. But we're not backing off of going through the defined contribution or 401k style system. And I got a text message from the Senator Dom who said, please explain what the word COLA means in case somebody doesn't know what it means. It is not a drink. COLA is a cost of living allowance, cost of living adjustment, so that way they're able to have a little bit more money in their pension. But the fact is that we're working on messaging, and we're not backing down from what it is that we know is what we know is the right thing to do.
I think I saw
Rick,
next
hand
right over
here. Sure. Let me follow up on that a bit.
I just want to follow up on that. Of course, that was about the unions or employee groups and pensions. But when it comes to, again, I mentioned earlier, tax consumers are very good at getting their message out. On education reform, education spending even, obviously education is one of the things we would say is a core function of government. But one of the local school districts up here have a budget of over $500,000 for public relations. They sent out a four-page, four-color thing sometime over last year that we all got at the Capitol as well. It was nothing but a pure propaganda piece about how we're,
are such horrible people and not sending the right kind of money to education and all that kind of stuff that I thought was almost criminal that they could take taxpayer money and put out that kind of campaign style piece. And so, again, that's why it's so important that you not believe everything that you read or hear, and that you also then turn around and in a very winsome, effective way, get the truth out to your neighbors and friends and family.
And don't pass the microphone down, but my voice carries. My voice carries, so I don't need a microphone. But to that point, as Dave was saying, is that I use my father as a guide. My father's 81 years old. My father works 6 days a week. He works 10 hours a day, and he says that he watches Fox News for those 10 hours a day while he's working. And my father reads the newspaper. He's engaged as probably the average, as much as the average voter is engaged. And my own father calls me and will call me at the Capitol and go, "Why are you doing this?" And I have to go, "We're not doing that." And he'll say, "But that's what I'm reading in the newspaper." And so we have to understand that people believe what they believe because that's the information base that they have. And even our own parents, even our own party, are going to believe it, they will believe what they're told. And that's the reason we've got to change the story. We've got to change the conversation back to what the truth actually is.
So next one right here, I think.
Yeah, we were talking earlier about strategy and differences of opinion, which I completely agree with. It's completely okay for conservatives to disagree and to have differences of opinion on strategy and how to get to the end goal. But what I've seen is that not always is strategy really just a difference of opinion. Sometimes strategy is just a cover for not wanting to do what they want to do. And for instance, at the federal level, we always hear that, hey, we're going to fight on the debt ceiling. And then it's the next debt ceiling, and then it's the next debt ceiling, and that's not really a strategy, that's just a continual excuse to just not take up the issue. So my question is, how do voters go about kind of discerning what are the real differences of opinion on strategy in the conservative movement, and what is kind of a false strategy, and is this something that members of the House legislature and Senate and House are going to work with the activists on kind of figuring out what's legitimate and what's not legitimate? Are these conversations you're willing to go on the record and say, you know, we disagree and that's not really a strategy, or, you know, that's my question.
That's a great question. And I think it is, it's a dialogue. It has to be that there are people that you trust so that even when you disagree, you know that it's an honest disagreement and not just a kind of a Trojan horse or a cover for something else. And I totally understand frustration, especially at the federal level. But it is also true, you know, I think probably most of us in this room would all be fans of George Washington. And, you know, if he would have tried to win every battle that he engaged in early on, we would have lost the Revolution. He knew that oftentimes he had to pick and choose his battles and to retreat from an awful lot of battles. And so I understand your frustration, but we do still have to pick and choose our battles and understand when it's appropriate to die on the hill, and when it's appropriate to go around the hill and fight the next battle.
He needs to jog up and down these stairs a little bit and get in shape. In my business, I think very much about brand. What am I presenting, the message I present to my customers, et cetera. And to me, brand is almost another word for integrity. And I have real concerns when a significant tax cut bill is written and submitted, does the leadership consider the damage to the Republican brand that can occur when the Senate Finance Chairman refuses to even hear the bill, allow it to be debated, allow it to be voted on?
Turn that over to the Senate Finance Vice Chair.
Just the Vice Chair. I'm the Chair of Vice. And I want to reiterate, I want to go back to what you're saying. I had this exact same conversation yesterday with a colleague, who's a Republican colleague, because I'm whipping, as we call it, my pension bill. And it has just actually been kind of just sailing through, and so I really wasn't worried about whipping it, then it was like, okay, I probably better go out and whip this bill, I mean, getting my vote count. And I've got right now up to 6 Republicans who are voting no. And I was I was losing it, with one of them, and the office door shut, and his comment was the same as yours, but the exact opposite, which was the Republican brand is being labeled that we're opposed to everything and we just want to hurt people. And I understood where he's coming from, because I will tell you, we hear that in the building every day, that Republicans do not like people, they do not like the poor, they do not like the elderly, they do not like teachers, they do not like education, and they do not care about our students. None of those things are true. My grandson is in public school. Our children are going to those schools. Some of us, if you're compared to Nathan Dom, are already elderly at the age of 52. You know, we live in the world in which we legislate. But I think there are some within, and I'm not addressing your answer point blank, I mean, on point, I understand that. But on the issue of brand, there are some who are very concerned that the Republican brand, where did Rhonda go? She's way outside. Is that Rhonda's heard me talk about this before. The one thing that we are bad at is messaging. The Democrats define for us every day who we are. We do not define for the rest of the world. And when we turn the defining of our party over to the Democrats, we are going to lose every single time. And until we are able to all the words I want to use, because I've been hanging around Leslie too long, I've got to clean them up. Until we man up and start defining ourselves, you are always going to have Republicans who are saying, I'm getting hammered from everybody, because the argument was made to me, we're taking on too much too fast. And my response back was, the alternative is to allow it to fall apart. We cannot stand back and allow it to fall apart and continue to fail. We do have to do this because, and this is where Pastor Rick comes out, is that we have been called at this time for this purpose. And we've got to man up, and as far as going back to your question, is that I agree with you, it is our brand, but we are lousy at branding. And we've got to be able to rebrand ourselves and redefine our message to be able to do everything that we need to do. And so that's not exactly what you wanted to say, but I think if we're going to talk about that, we got to deal with the realities. We're not good at this. We're very good at it. We just let somebody else do it better than we.
We have time for two more questions. Can I say something on that?
Can I say something real quick on that?
Yes.
just so if they don't know what the questioner is asking about, I think I know what he's asking about. Senator Dom and I introduced a tax cut down to 4% that Leslie and Tom and the House offers of, and we've been told we're not going to receive here in the Senate Finance Committee, of which Rick is the vice chair, but does not have the authority that the chair does. And he feels, as I alluded to earlier, I think he's from that group that feels the tax cuts should be revenue neutral, especially in a year where there's, not revenue growth. And obviously Nathan and I won't even have a bill heard. So, you know where we stand, but I guess to try and articulate what the chairman would say if he were here, that's probably what he would say. And I think he would say, that our brand is tarnished when we do things that, in his view, look reckless. Obviously, we have a totally different take on that, but that's what he would say, because we do hear from people all the time who think that it's irresponsible to have a tax cut without, revenue offset. So, I'm not of that view, obviously, as you know, the author of the bill. I'm trying to kind of, though, help you, I want to use this word necessarily, but know thy enemy, so you understand where they're coming from. And maybe you can, Mike maybe is a conservative Republican. I mean, we need to find a way to find some common ground on these issues.
Should be green when you push it.
Okay, my question refers to a comment earlier about how we should support conservative candidates within the Republican Party. And when you look at things that are going on, it's real easy to identify a Democrat. But in the Republican Party, we have a problem as a voter because so much goes on that we can't keep up with everything these days. So is there some way or something that you can tell us to help tell the difference between a conservative Republican and a Democrat in drag.
I guess the simple answer to that would be, and Leslie and I were asked the question earlier about if there's some way that people can be aware of the bills coming up. But, I mean, OCPA Impact, the 912 Project, or some other great organizations, probably the best thing to do would be to support them, get on their mailing lists, and they can help keep you informed and all of that. I do want to mention one thing. I saw him come in earlier. Leslie and I both mentioned that we just recently had a new speaker's election, and therefore it was going to be more difficult to get some of our conservative things done. Our former speaker, he's going to be introduced in a minute, going to talk to you, I think, but we were blessed to have him because he was someone who understood messaging. He was someone that could help some of that squishy middle of our caucus to understand the conservative ideas and embolden them to vote for it. And so when he comes up in just a few minutes, I want you to understand that we've had the most conservative speaker in state history in T.W. Shannon.
Question is, you've got to hold your representatives and senators accountable for what they vote for. You may not always be able to affect what they will vote for in the future because you may not even know about that vote prior to it happening. But you're going to hear about it after. I mean, anybody can pull up the House and Senate website. You see it's in the tax cut bill, say, when one goes down, pull up the history. And if your senator or representative is on there, call them. It is amazing. I have 38,000 constituents. That's what every House member has. How very little input I receive from a constituent on any issue. And usually the ones that I do hear from are OEA members because they get the indoctrination from the teachers union. And you do realize we give over half our budget to education. We have 78 appropriated agencies, and I am not anti-education. That's what you need to keep impressing upon them, is some people still want us to take care of foster kids and make sure we have a system of infrastructure and lock up the bad guys. So, you know, we could get the whole budget to education and it still wouldn't be enough. So some point we must cut administrative costs. And if we cut administrative costs by 15% in every school, every teacher could probably have a $3,000 or $4,000 pay raise overnight. That's what we need.
Can I say something real quick? I'm from the Chamber of Unlimited Debate. I'm sorry. I was also going to say one insider tip to answer the gentleman's question about how you tell, you know, conservatives is look at the bills they author too. You know, not just their voting record, because Senator Dahl and I are starting to challenge each other for bills that never get heard. Yeah, and so you'll never hear about them, but we're still very proud of them. We put a lot of work into them, and we're trying to put out some conservative ideas. So, I mean, I think that's something worth looking at, too, is if you're really interested. I mean, that's a little wonky, kind of a bad way to use a Saturday, but so is this, right? So, you know, go ahead and look a little deeper at the legislators and the kind of stuff that they're offering, what the ideas they're putting out there. And that, I think, really gives you an insight into their heart.
I think we have time for this last question.
All right. This is to try to tie some of this together here, what all of you said about your caucus and about some of the less than firm Republicans that are there. You know, we gave you all a mandate. Statewide, every elected official is Republican, super majorities in both houses. I think all of us would hope that we wouldn't need to be on your case for you to carry out what we sent you there to do, gave you an overwhelming majority to do. And yet, we're finding out, as we found out with Senate Bill 906 this week, that we can't leave it alone, that there are senators and presumably House members, too, who unless they hear from a lobbyist, they're not going to believe that there is another side to the story. So my question is, you know, thankfully, there were 18 Republicans in the Senate who voted against Senate Bill 906. And thank you to everyone who's here today voted against it. Every House member that I've heard have asked about it and said that they would not support it in the House, and I'm thankful for that. How can we tell when we, assuming that as Representative Newell said, it's maybe ineffective to do a primary challenge, when we have an open seat opportunity, how can we tell what character qualities should we be looking for these candidates beyond just being able to parrot conservative rhetoric? What kind of character qualities should we be sending so that they know and do the right thing even when they are under assault by lobbyists and hearing from the OEA and all that?
When it comes to character, I defer to Pastor Rick. I'm going to give him the mic in a second. But one thing I want to say is, because I see this all the time, David, I've had this conversation many times about candidates, you know, they need to have a core set of principles. You know, I can tell you, if you give me an idea of a bill, I can tell you in 5 minutes. I mean, as soon as I understand your bill, I can tell you whether I'm for it or against it, or whether I might be bending something out of some pragmatic reality, you know, but I can tell you then when I'm doing that too. I can say, well, here's what my principle says, but here, you know, but that taking that principle out to its natural conclusion leads to an illogical result, and so I'm doing this, you know. Not a lot of our colleagues necessarily have a ton of experience in government. We don't actually, surprisingly, don't serve with a lot of people who are mayors or city councilmen or anything, really. This was their first political office. And so they think they're really conservative, but they haven't really had it tested, you know, and had a, you know, been able to really articulate a series of principles. And so I don't know how you test that exactly, but I think you really have to drill down with people when they're running for office to make sure they really understand the rhetoric that they're, you know, that they're saying. If they really understand how that ends up applying and how that's going to make some people mad when they get into the Capitol, and are they ready to stand up to that onslaught, because they can be pretty vicious. With that, on character, I defer again to Pastor Rick.
The one thing I would say is that it's kind of cliche, but being in that building does not develop character. It reveals character. And what happens is that in all practicality, I mean, I'm not speaking ill of anybody or speaking pro of anybody. You see men and women who step up to the plate and they are leaders and they knock it out of the ballpark and they're awesome and people want to be like them. And you see people that you really, really like, and they make very poor personal choices when they're at the Capitol. But the reality is that those exact same qualities were in those people when they showed up at the door. The stress that you were under, I mean, and this is not an exaggeration. There was a colleague over in the House, you know, the lives of their children were threatened. You know, when you live in a world where somebody has the audacity to threaten the life of your child, It does shake you occasionally. That's the extreme. So I'm not going to always fault somebody because I don't know the complete pressures that they may be under. But if you have never been in a position in your life where people stand up and call you names and yell at you and tell you that you're stupid and you have to deal with that 24/7, comes a point where some people just bend and break. And I'm not going to stand in judgment of them. I can stand in frustration of them, but I'm not going to stand in judgment of them. You know, this week, it was the funniest thing. In the morning, I was named Legislator of the Year by one group, and in the afternoon, I was called the Antichrist by another group. I'm like, wow, I covered the whole gamut in one day. And so I think when you get to the issue of character, it's not what you can mouth. It's not what you can mouth. It's whether or not you see those people in their day-to-day lives who are willing to stand up to the pressure and to stand up for what's right. The other thing, too, as you talked about the supermajorities, when you have 71 Republicans in the House, that's a different ballgame than when you had 51 Republicans in the House. They had to hold tight. They had to be together. When we were elected, there were 32 Republicans. Before that, there was 26. We had a one-vote majority. You had to hold tight because you had to have everyone together. When you get to the supermajority, you don't have to have everybody to get your bill passed. And they know that. And then that is where, that's where the games start. Because you don't have to hang tight, because we don't need everyone's vote to get something done. So you would think it would be easier in a supermajority. I think it's actually more difficult when you've got that narrow margin of victory. There is a bond that unites the group to stay together in just a practical sense. But as far as character, you need to know the person's character before you send them up there. Don't try to figure it out after they get there.
Is this on?
Let's give a big thank you.